sole ed ancora più su, mentre il mondo pian piano spariva lontano laggiù. Una musica dolce suonava soltanto per me. Volare, oh oh, cantare, oh oh oh, e nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù. Penso che sogno coi non rotino mai più. Mi dimiglievo le mani, le fascia di blu, e poi di primizio venivo dal vento rapito, e cominciavo a volare nel cielo infinito. Volare, oh, oh, cantare, oh, 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 yeah, come on in, girls, let's go. Volare, oh, oh, mangiare, oh, 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 e nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù, e nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù, e nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù. Welcome everybody to Pizza Parmigiana Pavarotti.
Buongiorno.
Buongiorno, buongiorno. How are we today, Lisa Goldberg?
Fantastic.
And how are we today, Lisa Donport? Bella, bella, bella. So, before we get into things, I'd just like to remind everyone at home that there is a chat online and we'll be answering your questions all day. I think that's Lisa's coming.
My job.
We are so excited. There's been a lot of planning involved. And look, I sing, we do music, you guys cook. Our duo gastromagies, so I don't know what, and my Italian is chetti chetti. Caca, caca. Okay, so.
Cozy, cozy.
Oh, cozy, cozy. Grazie, grazie. We have such a beautiful show planned. We have opera by Eleanor and Vlad. We had Eddie Bronson on the accordion, and we had Ben Adler on the violin then, and you guys at home. So.
Fantastic.
What are you doing
welcome,
here?
Welcome guys. This morning we are workshopping traditional Italian pizza.
Lovely, and what are you drinking?
And I'm drinking Campari to remember what Italy was once like when we used to be able to go there.
Sure, and you've been to Italy?
I have, it's a sweet distant memory.
Oh, okay. One story, anything?
Campari, I think, answers it all.
Campari, and pizza. And
yeah,
pizza.
What is your favourite thing in Italy?
My favourite thing in Italy is pizza bianco.
Ah, what is that?
White pizza.
Are you going to tell us about
garlic?
It?
Garlic, yes, you got to be patient.
That's one thing I'm not. Okay, so.
Okay, let's go. Here we are this morning.
Do you have a
and it really is a whole lot simpler than everybody thinks. You know, over isolation, a lot of people were puzzling, a lot of people were knitting, and for us, we really defined sourdough culture. It's super exciting, and I'm so glad to be sharing this morning. So there's a couple of simple things that we need to learn. The first thing is the flour we use. Yes, you can use plain flour. It is better to be using doppio zero, double zero. It's the Italian grading of their flour and it's super fine. It's available in all supermarkets and readily available these days. That's what it looks like. The second thing is the sourdough culture. And traditionally we do use yeast. The sourdough culture is fermented naturally. So the thing with pizza making is you need more time. You do need to make the dough earlier on and you need to let it relax. The sourdough culture, over isolation, a lot of the bakeries were giving away their culture because it's a mother, it's a live organism that needs feeding every day. So you have to feed it water and more flour. So it was growing. And during isolation, when there wasn't the need to be making bread, a lot of the bakers were giving away that mother. Now, feeding it every day, you can have some for over 30, 50 years old or older. And the older it is, the richer the ferment is. So, yes, you can go to your baker and to see whether they'll give you some sourdough starter. Or you can make it yourself, start from scratch. It does take quite a bit of time. Or you do what I do and you just have in your cupboard sourdough culture in a sachet. It's just like dry yeast. It looks just like dry yeast. And it's absolutely amazing to work with, which I'm going to show you later on. The other thing you really need is a heavy base fry pan and a cast iron pan. It needs to be really thick and heavy, which gets it very hot. And in terms of getting a beautiful crusty base like you would in a wood fire oven, it's a cast iron pan, a very heavy pan is the preference. Okay, so let's start. It really is that simple. It's so foolproof, it will be very hard to make any mistakes. So we have our super fine doppio zero flour. We're going to sift that into the bowl. To that, we're going to add our salt, 3 teaspoons of salt, and a sachet of our sourdough culture. If you don't have that, you can use yeast. This recipe makes around 6 individual small pizza. Okay, so we just mix the culture, the salt, in with the flour, and then we're going to add our water. It's these ingredients. That's it. Yes, traditionally I would be mixing the flour and the water in with my hands, but hey, I can't be doing that today. So this is the dough. It is very different to what yeast looks like, okay? It handles very differently to yeast. It's very sticky, and you may think it's too wet, but really that is exactly how it should be looking. It smells absolutely incredible. You know, yeast has a flavour and it smells like a bakery. This is more of a fermented smell. It smells more like a brewery rather than a bakery. Okay, you can see how wet that dough is, and that's exactly how it should be. We're going to let this rest. You just cover it lightly with a film of glad wrap, really lightly. Don't stick it to the outside of the bowl. And then this needs to sit for at least 24 hours. Leave it to the side of your bench and you will just see it grow. It can be there for up to 36 hours. Okay, that is live. That's a live organism right there. So now we're going to talk about, I just have to show you, isn't this magnificent? Mezzaluna. Mezza meaning half. It's a wonderful thing. We're going to be using that later on. Okay, so the 4 toppings we're making today are really traditional toppings. I know the Aussies like to throw on the pineapple and 3 different cheeses and, you know, the whole kitchen sink. Try and keep it simple. The simpler are really the most traditional. So margherita, the margherita everyone knows, it's a traditional, it's a passata base. It's raw tomatoes and it's grated and it's not cooked. You place the passata on the pizza and then the bocconcini. I like to use the baby bocconcini. The second pizza is the pizza patata, which is a potato pizza, very traditional. There is no tomato base. It's the finely sliced potato, which is being blanched. So I peeled the potato, finely sliced the potato, had it sitting in a bowl, blanched it for maybe 10 minutes and drained it. and then refreshed it in cold water. Remember, when you're working with starch, that it will continue cooking in the heat, so you need to cool it down. The same with eggs, just by the way. When you hard boil eggs or soft boil eggs, you need to very quickly drain it out of the hot water, refresh it in cold water. So on the potato pizza, it's no tomato base, just the potatoes, olive oil, lots of salt. The other pizza is the salsa pizza, which is the salami. I have veal salami, which is available in quite a few supermarkets. And that has the passata on the base with the salami. And my most favourite, which Ilan asked before, was the pizza bianco. Bianco is white, and you will rarely see it in Australia on menus, but you can always ask for it. It's the very basic, the dough with olive oil and garlic and lots of salt, and it is delicious. And really all you do with that, with the fresh garlic, over a grater or anything that you have that can finally make the garlic into a paste. I have this wonderful dish here which has grating teeth on the surface, and it collects the mince of the garlic. Remember, when you're cooking with garlic, it was created with the skin, and the skin is so you don't smell. It's so your fingers don't smell. It's your natural guard on the garlic. So we, with the minced garlic, we add some olive oil. And this will be ready for our pizza bianco. Okay, so that's really our toppings. And we are going to let the dough rest. We will be coming back later on to finish off our pizza. But hang on a minute. I hear some music.
Thank you. Buongiorno a tutti! Benvenuti su Dunera Project! Mi chiamo Eleonora Leone, a.k.a. Eleanor Lyons. Vi presento il mio marito, molto talentoso, Vladimir Fanshil. In English! Hi everyone, I'm Eleanor. I'm a Sydney-born soprano, and this is my husband, Vladimir Fanshil, conductor and pianist. We're so happy to be here today to perform for you on Dunera Live. We hope you're all cooking along and enjoying the smells of your kitchen to our music. If you enjoyed this, you could invite us to your home. We are doing a special project called Live at Yours, liveatyours.com.au. Is that for me?
It is for you.
Oh, my goodness.
Everyone at home, I'd just like you all to just write your beautiful comments for Eleanor and Vlad. Bravo, bravo. And this is a Campari for you.
Oh, grazie.
I'm going to take that. Would you like to sing another song?
I would. I'd love to sing for you. Cilea, io son l'umile ancella.
Just keep talking. It's like you're crying. You feel the music so deeply, Eleanor.
Of course. This particular aria is about a singer singing about singing. You can't really write anything better because it's so emotional singing about how much I love to sing.
Beautiful. Well, we can tell that you love it so much. And Vlad, it's just so wonderful to see such a beautiful couple. Just so beautiful. Anyway, I interrupted you guys before. What were you talking about? You were talking about like a dot-com thing that you guys are doing, like a live at yours kind of program. What is that?
So basically, we miss you. All you people out there who are listening and watching today, we actually want to get in your face and with all the suitable social restrictions, of course. But we're very passionate about connecting with people in a live way. And we particularly love intimate spaces and salon concerts.
Not too intimate, because I understand the saliva spritz with opera can be a bit kind of effective. But, you know, all the same, we don't mind
all
over here.
All for the sake of art.
All for the sake of art. Now, talking about art, we have two artists in the kitchen right now, Lisa Goldberg and Melissa Donport. And I'm going to cross back to them. I understand that you guys have been writing some pretty cool questions. Are you guys ready? Fabulous. Here we go. Crossing over.
Bellissimo. So just remember, we are live and you can be typing in your questions. We have Lisa here who will be mediating. Lisa, tell me, have we questions?
Yeah, there are a few, but the first thing, I've just got to read the best comment so far, is sourdough needs to relax, don't we all? I think that's a really good way to start off this segment. I'll ask you one question before you get onto the dough. Is someone wants to know if you can use gluten-free flour for this?
Yes. Gluten-free flour is really corn flour. You can, and it's really worth experimenting. It really is. Yeah.
Okay, I think you better get your dough going, and then we'll ask some more in a minute.
Okay. So look at this. Can you see the bubbles in this dough? It's absolutely gorgeous. So I made this 24 hours ago. Let me go back a step. So in the bowl that we saw that sat in the kitchen overnight, you then, traditionally we call it knockback, where you get your fist in the big bowl of the yeast and you really punch it out. With sourdough culture, it really is with your hands, with a movement around the bowl, bringing the dough together. It's super sticky, and that's how it's meant to be. And then you let that rest again. The more you move it around and activate it and then let it rest, the more the product is exactly like this. Okay, so you let it rest a second time. You then want to divide it up into dough. And it's important with the dough to remember that you can freeze it. Don't be nervous in moving it around. Okay, so I normally work on about 200 grams per pizza. I divided the dough up. And once the dough is divided, you can then freeze them individually into bags, or you can work with it straight away. You can put it in the fridge and leave it there for a few days, and the dough can be frozen. Okay, so here we go. We want to try and keep the outside of the dough, and we only are working towards the inside. What we have to do is place our pan on the heat. So as we have our dough ready to go, we have a very, very, very hot cast iron pan, and we have our griller on high heat. Okay, so the pan needs to be super, super hot, like the floor of a wood fire oven, and then the griller on the top to finish off the cooking. It is that simple. It really doesn't take a lot of work. Don't be nervous about it. There's a lot of playing around. I did have a question early on this morning, where do you get sourdough culture? You just Google sourdough culture sachets and you will find what you're looking for. Okay, so how do you check a pan if a pan is hot? Sit your hand over the top, obviously not touching the pan, and you can feel the heat. You don't oil the pan, there's nothing to go in the pan. That pan is ready and the griller is hot. Look at that baby. That is gorgeous.
You are cooking a pizza. I'm late on this. You guys are cooking a pizza in a fry pan?
In a fry pan. It's our wood fire oven equivalent. Wait till you see this.
I can't wait. Look at it. Oh my goodness. And there's that beautiful bubble in it.
Yeah.
Is that normal?
That is normal. That's gorgeous. Okay. So we're just going to move the dough around. Yes.
You're very good at that.
You can spin it over your head. And we're just going to place this into the very, very hot pan. Okay, in the pan it goes. We want to move with our fingers, work around the pan. We're making the margarita. So with the margarita is the passata, which goes straight on top. We have our baby bocconcini, really, you know, anything or your favourite toppings. The passata goes on top. I like to leave a little bit on the outside so you can see the beautiful dough. We have some baby bocconcini on top. Honestly, it's a couple of minutes, literally a couple of minutes. Okay, we're going to check under the pizza to see its colour, a little bit longer. So remember, the beauty about this dough is that it may take a few days to make it, but double the recipe and individually freeze the pizza. So when you feel like pizza, you bring it out the night before or bring it out in the morning, the dough, let it come back to room temperature, let it rise again, and then off you go. It's really that simple. It smells delicious. You should see, you should smell. It's absolutely crazy. Lisa, how are we going with questions?
Okay, an interesting question. Is there an issue with kosher and the starter?
That would need to be checked depending on which starter. If you're buying a sachet, that would need to be checked. If you're making it yourself, absolutely not. Okay, because it's basically the flour and the water.
Yeah, you could adjust it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, just make your own. Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Make your own.
Make it sound so easy to make your own starter.
No,
it is. Have you ever done it, Mel? Oh.
No, it is fiddly.
It is.
And once you start it, it's like a baby, so you have to keep on feeding it.
Yeah.
It's a continual, you have to continually nurse it, feed it. Ah, I can smell.
It's like a mix of chemistry and art. That's what I find what you're doing right
okay,
now.
Okay, so I want to show you the base. Look at that. That is like a wood fire oven. So it's 3 minutes or so in the very hot pan, and then we go under into the griller, under a very, very hot griller, just to brown off the top and to melt the cheese. It really is that simple. Don't forget, send us, we are live, send us questions, happy to talk, anything pizza, anything sourdough.
I just want to give a shout out to Montefiore Hunters Hill. They're tuning in and watching. Hey, everybody there.
Hi,
and
guys.
A special shout out to everybody in Melbourne because you are doing it tough down there and we're with you in spirit. Okay, another question, Mel. Can you make the dough and freeze it once
yes.
it's risen or before it's risen? When do you do that?
No, so once you've made the dough and you knock it back and then you let it rise a second time and then you shape it into balls, that's when you freeze it. So it's the third stage of making the dough. You can freeze it and you can leave it in the fridge for a week or so.
Oh.
Yeah.
I've got a question, just a quick one.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if you've covered this, but I notice a lot of people get carried away with their ingredients. Are there too many ingredients you can put on a pizza?
Yes. Yes, there are.
Because I notice these are quite kind of...
traditional.
Traditional.
And that's exactly
simple,
right.
Simple.
We did mention before, keep them simple. Keep your toppings simple.
Is there a golden rule, like a 3 max topping kind of thing? Or
let me just show you how good that's looking.
Right.
Isn't that gorgeous? That's gorgeous. No, you know, you just need to think about traditional pizza and you need to think about the different toppings and really an Italian pizza will have two or three and that's it.
See, let me loose in my kitchen. I'm throwing in pesto and artichoke hearts and mushrooms and capsicum and sage and everything.
Too much.
No, okay.
I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. Not at all. That's great.
I just want to tell everybody, this dough, I have never felt anything quite like it.
Yeah.
It is so soft and plump and airy and it just feels like better than a baby's bottom, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, it is beautiful. And it is there is a big difference between using yeast and between using sourdough culture.
Now, Lisa, when we did the babkas, because we baked babka, I remember the dough in that show was just so soft and beautiful. What's the textural difference to you here?
That one had butter and oil in it, so it had that, like, a sort of, not a fatty feel, but more of a fat feel. Then this one is almost dry but beautiful. I can't even describe it. Have you felt that?
I haven't felt it yet. Oh, goodness.
Yeah, it's something else, isn't it?
Beautiful, beautiful. I'm getting hungry. I'm starting anyway.
Smells good.
And it's a miracle that there's just so few ingredients in that to create something so magnificent.
Yeah. I think the beauty of this dough is it's really a whole lot simpler than you think it is. You really need to give it a go because it's foolproof. You can't make any mistakes. It will just continually grow. So the minute you put anything into the fridge, you're stopping that growth, okay? So you have an avocado that is underripe. You put it in the fridge, it's going to stop the maturing process, okay? That's why you never put anything in the fridge until it's ready and at its perfect point. Okay, so here we are. Look at this.
Wow,
we have
beautiful.
Absolutely beautiful. So we have using a little bit of muscle here.
Well
loosen
done.
Loosen the base.
Bravo.
Bravo.
Bravo, bravo, bravo.
Bravo, bravo.
Looks have you amazing. Enjoyed the music, by the way, Mel?
Absolutely.
You can't hear it over in the kitchen.
Absolutely.
I love how wafts over.
Just so good. We have a little bit of olive oil. We have our baby basil leaves. And we have our mezzaluna. Listen to this crunch.
Amazing. Another shout out to Wheatso Masada in Melbourne and Emmanuel Synagogue in Sydney. And someone is watching from Vancouver, which is fantastic. Hello, everyone, and welcome. Please type in your questions. We've got another couple of minutes where we can answer your questions.
Beautiful. Okay.
Yeah, there are other cereal offenders with too many toppings on there as well. Yeah, yeah.
That happens a lot. Okay, so what you always need with a pizza is a Campari.
Yeah, I agree. To me, Campari goes with anything, any time of the day. We thought it was maybe a bit early to have a Negroni, which is the, you know, the drink you make from Campari. So we're just going to go simple today, okay? You just need a glass. I prefer a glass without a stem for this. I'm going to put in some ice. And there's a lot of discussion about ice these days, actually, about, you know, the big cubes.
The big cube.
I like this sort of cube, like smaller for a Campari soda.
Yeah.
Essential orange. Okay, a little peel.
Yeah.
I think that's the secret ingredient. And give it a little bit of a massage to get the oils happening.
Yeah, bruise it.
And remember, you need to have washed your orange very well to get all the wax and whatever else they put in it.
Yeah.
On it. That in
gorgeous.
There. A little Campari.
The thing with the big ice cube is it doesn't melt as quickly. So if you don't want water in your drink,
that's right.
You know, if you have the smaller cubes, you're going to get diluted.
Perfect for a Negroni. Yeah. But for this, and just a splash of mineral water, soda water works beautifully. Will you have this one? Can I give this to you?
Yeah, beautiful.
Campari, what do I have to say? Campari è pronto.
Grazie.
And we say salute.
Salute. Grazie, grazie. Okay. I think we are ready. We were going to mention our biscotte recipe.
Ah, yes. I just want to show you one of these. This is actually a non-traditional biscotti. It's a biscotti because it's cooked twice, but it's a different recipe because it has oil in it. So it's a slightly different thing to the traditional, which doesn't. And I did this for Dunera last week. So you can find that on the on-demand, the biscotti
beautiful.
Little cooking demo, and they're delicious.
Gorgeous.
And you must have a taste afterwards.
Gorgeous.
Are we ready to eat pizza
very
yet
good.
Or not? Yes.
Okay. Pranzo e siete. Lunch is served, guys. Let's go. So let me show you here the pizzas that we have. Can you see here we have the potato? It's the potato with the olive oil. It's the margherita. We have a salami. And this is the bianco. The bianco, which is really just garlic, olive oil, lots of salt. Lots
lovely.
Of salt.
Smells incredible. Smells absolutely amazing. We might come around here, and while the aromas of Italy are filling this kitchen, we might, if you like, at home, play one more song for you. It's been wonderful having you two in the kitchen, especially you, Melissa. It's wonderful to see you work.
Thank you.
And come on in, Ben, and come on in. Eddie Bronson. On my left, your right, I'm pretty sure, and Ben Adler on violin. Come on in. I believe, actually, I was going to come here. Yep. And I'm just going to grab this. How are you doing, everyone? Have you had a good time? Okay, so we're ready to go. Ready?
Parla più piano e nessuno sentirà. Il nostro amore io viviamo io. Nessuno sa la verità, neppure il cielo che ci guarda da lassù. E insieme a te io resterò, e amore mio, sempre così. Parla più piano e vieni più vicino a me. Voglio sentire gli occhi miei dentro di te. Nessuno sa la verità. Grande amore, mai più grande esisterà. Nessuno sa la verità, e un grande amore e mai più grande esisterà.
Thank you so much. It's not time to go yet. We have one more beautiful surprise, but before we do go, we'd like to all of us thank Dunera for making this happen, giving us the opportunity to show you some beautiful cooking, to play some beautiful music for you. And just, you know, we're very thankful to be able to do this for you. And we hope you guys are too. To everyone at home, be patient, be loving, care for each other, and you know, do everything with a little bit of Italian in your heart, huh? Beautiful cooking. Lisa, thank you very much for being here. Yeah. Now, Lisa, just quickly before we run away and pass back over to Eleanor and Vlad, can you just tell us what's happening like in the next like week or two? Have you got anything happening on Dunera?
We've got lots of things happening, Mondays and Thursdays, but you've got to check the website because everything is there. And don't forget the on-demand stuff. Like, that's a lot of people overlook that. Everything is recorded and everything is there to watch again.
Yeah, so just to be clear, the on-demand is the replay section. So basically, if you want to watch anything, you just replay it and you go to the on-demand section and it's all in there. So if one of your friends missed today, just get them to go to the on-demand section and there it is. Also, you can press the search on www.dunera.org.au, and the search button, you can basically put in Lisa Goldberg or Melissa, and everything that Melissa's done will come up. Now, before I thank our wonderful gastronomy behind me, I'd just like to make a mention of this week on Sunday at 6 p.m. on Synchronicity. We have Ben Adler's band, Chutney, playing, and it's going to be incredible. We have such an amazing, amazing show planned for you guys. Again, thank you for tuning in. So this Sunday at 6 p.m., I'm hosting Synchronicity, and Ben Adler's band, Chutney, will be on there. Everyone at home, thank these musicians. They're giving their time, they're giving their love to you guys. And now, please thank Melissa Donpod for a beautiful, beautiful show. Thank you.
Pleasure, absolute pleasure.
Yeah?
We've got plenty of pizza here and we are hungry.
We are hungry. So, we're going to eat, but while we eat and while you guys are at home, we're going to pass to Eleanor Lyons and Vladimir Fanshil for their climactic piece. Grazie mille, everybody. Thank you so much. Thanks for having us. Grazie.
Oh,